My name is Charlie Meeker, and this is Nathan Lewis, who is the pastor of this church here, and this is Bernie Dehler, who is the coordinator of Side Religion. Is that, I never knew how to pronounce that.
It's a science and religion discussion
group. Okay, science and religion. That's
why I changed it, because nobody could pronounce it. So.
Okay. Tonight, we're going to be discussing natural theology, and these two gentlemen have read this book here. It's 600 and some odd pages, and no, you were not expected to read this beforehand. Your moderator will confess to you freely that I read the introduction and half of one chapter, so I'm not completely up on it. Bernie's going to first give the atheist, secular, humanist presentation. He'll have about 10 minutes to do that. And then Nathan will have about 10 minutes to present the Christian perspective. And then your moderator will ask each of them some questions to try to challenge their presentations, and then they will ask questions of each other. So without any further ado, and I should also say that you have 10 minutes to make your presentation. If you want to, if you would like to take an extra minute to advertise whatever you'd like to advertise, like groups that might be of interest to people that share your point of view or that don't share your point of view, you're free to do that. So go ahead, Bernie.
Okay, my name is Bernie Dehler. I'm a former evangelical Christian. I used to preach the gospel on cable TV and the internet. And after 27 years, I got actually a master's in ministry degree also, and then I became an atheist after debating an atheist. So since 2009, I'm an atheist. More specifically, I would like to promote secular humanism, which I'll explain later. And so for people, if you want to know how to meet other atheists, a good place to go, and agnostics, is meetup.com, and you can put in atheist, for example, and you'll see my website and discussion group, the Vancouver discussion group. You'll also see CFI group, which is a center for inquiry. There's also a Humanist Greater Portland, and then some other groups too, like the Flying Spaghetti Monster, Lands for a Pint, and some other atheist groups. So it's a good way to get to know other atheists. If you're interested, just go to meetup.com. Okay, for 10 minutes?
Go ahead.
Can you give me like a minute warning
okay.
At the end and like 30 seconds or so? Okay, so we'll go to the first slide. I have a whole bunch of slides here, so I'm not going to probably get through all of them. So some of these I probably just won't even touch on, and maybe I'll come back to them later. And if they're up there for a second and they're interesting, we can come back to it in the Q&A session. So basically, this is my presentation for tonight. I'm going to talk about secular humanism, which is an atheistic worldview, and then some major points on this book that I've read. Next page. So basically, I want you to hold me accountable to this. Secular humanism is a naturalistic belief system, which means there's nothing supernatural entertained. It's all considered the supernatural as superstition. And it promotes critical thinking and morality by using modern science and reason. Next page. So what is natural theology, since that's the name of this book? This is something I edited, I found from the internet. Natural theology is a branch of theology based on reason and ordinary experience. So it's distinguished from revealed theology, which is based on the scripture and religious experiences of various kinds. So nowhere do they appeal to the scripture. This is all about what we can observe from logic and reason. And so what does revelation mean? Well, that's where you say, well, I know this because God told me, or God told this other person who told me, and this other person's called a prophet. So that stuff is not allowed in natural theology. Next page. This kind of reminds me of the last debate we had where somebody in the audience said, it sounded like I was standing for reason and logic, and Pastor Nathan was kind of more of an emotional approach. So this is kind of a joke to illustrate that. It's actually quite common, I think, sometimes to see appeals to emotion. So basically, it's not about emotions. Emotions do not determine truth whatsoever. We could deal with the emotions. And I would also combat the idea that atheism is a negative, brings negative emotions. And that's something I could talk about in the Q&A if you want to bring it up. But there's a lot of positive emotional aspects to atheism also. And I think it's in general, it's neutral. It's not negative or positive. Although you can see it either way, depending on how you want to look at it. Next. So these are basically all the chapters of the book.
and I'll go over some of these. Next page. So one overview I wanted to say is, you'll notice there's no talk in here about DNA, what DNA tells us, because DNA, by the experts, shows that evolution is pretty much a done deal from genomics. So notice what's missing from this book. Not one talk about DNA, nothing about the flood, whether it's a local or global flood, because the smartest academics know that's a myth. So it's interesting to know what's missing. There's no talk in here about the fossil record, for example. Because there's nothing they can argue with about the atheist or the atheistic worldview. Next page. Quite often they use up Bayesian probabilities, and I think whenever I see these Bayesian arguments, I think they're nonsense, because basically, for example, there's one in there where they say, okay, let's just start out with the assumption that God exists, and we'll put a 0.9 probability on that. It's like, where'd you get 0.9? Maybe it could be 0.8, 0.7, 0.6. They just pulled it out of the air. When you're dealing with math and statistics, that's not accurate. You can't just pull any number you want to. It's unjustified. It's just garbage in, garbage out. So this, whenever I see these Bayesian math things, I just think they're nonsense. And there's some apologists, I think, who also agree with that. They say that's a poor way to argue with faith. Next page. There's also something to be aware of called the argument from ignorance, where basically somebody says, oh, I believe that God did the Big Bang. And it's like, well, I don't think so. And they go, well, how can you disprove it? Well, I can't really disprove it. Okay, well, therefore, then I win. No, just because nobody knows doesn't mean your viewpoint wins. That's going to come up frequently, more than once. Next page. So the cosmological argument is, why is there something rather than nothing? And then, you know, sometimes now with the multiverse, it's like, oh, there's all of these universes out there. So sometimes the people say, well, that question actually has been modified to now, why is there something rather than everything? And then sometimes the answer is, well, God made this universe. Well, then another interesting question is, you know, who made God? You know, special pleading to say, well, he doesn't need a maker. But you know, another thing too is like, why is there something rather than nothing? You can say, well, God made it. But why is there a God rather than nothing? God is also something too. Why is there God? Why couldn't it have been that there never was a God, there never was a universe, there never was anything? How is it that there is actually even a God? So really what this shows is that when you say God did this, it answers nothing. God's not even an answer. All it just says it's a mystery. And instead of saying mystery, you say God. It's a non-answer. Next page. So I was just saying here, the best answer is we don't know, considering, you know, like we don't even know what gravity is. There's hypotheses, maybe there's a graviton, a massless spin 2 boson. You know, we're not even sure of these things. We used to think time was something separate, and now they talk about space-time as a fabric. So there's a lot of things we don't know about. We can experience 4 dimensions, but in string theory, there may be 11 dimensions. So, you know, can't even comprehend 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. You know, maybe there's 30 dimensions, maybe there's 100, who knows? So there's a lot of ignorance that we have here. Okay, next page. Oh, and then, so on the cosmological argument, you know, I really always, in my debates, try to never say, like, this is a stupid argument or anything, but this one just kind of blew me away that William Lane Craig wrote this. You know, he talked about the details of quantum mechanics and general relativity. A lot of hardcore science there, and then he says something like this, which I just thought was just totally ridiculous. He says, you know, the atheist says, well, something can come from nothing, meaning that, like in quantum mechanics, we could have material pop out of a field, so there was no material there, and it pops out, and all this energy could have been the start, you know, for the universe. So he goes, well, you know what? If the universe can pop out of nothing, then why can't other things like bicycles or root beer, you know, or, you know, you and me? It's like, well, you know, I can't believe he said that, because we know these things are consisting of other materials. They're assembled over a long time, and they have components. Nobody is thinking something complex popped into nothing. It's just energy. It's just some of the basic material of the universe, especially the first particles and things. So I thought that was just crazy to say, because an atheist thinks that the universe came from nothing, then it's like, well, that's like saying, hey, why not bicycles? I mean, it's like, I don't know how you even had to, it was just mind-boggling to me, he would say that. Next line. On the teleological argument, this is basically look around and see the design of the world. This is evidence for God. And really, all it's doing is playing with the God of the gaps. We don't know these answers, and they say, aha, God's the answer. So notice they're always playing with the things we don't know, like the fine-tuning of the laws of nature. Maybe they're fine-tuned, maybe they're not. Fine-tuning the constants of nature. Yeah, so this is, they're not sure if constants are even standalone or if they're dependent on other things. Fine-tuning of initial conditions of the universe. For here, they don't really consider the multiverse theory, so they just think the universe came from nothing, God spoke it into existence, which is kind of interesting because a lot of Christians, some Christians don't even like the Big Bang Theory, and some of them think that God caused it. But some people, you know, if you say that the universe is fine-tuned for life, some people might say, well, you could actually turn that around and say it's fine-tuned for death. Look on Earth how most of the Earth is inhospitable to life. Most of the space is inhospitable to life. Maybe it's fine-tuned for black holes. There's a lot of black holes out there, and our sun may blow up and become a black hole too. So maybe it's not designed for life. Maybe it's designed for black holes, you know? So there's a lot of questions here, but basically they're trying to go to this playground of the unknown. Next page. And then some of the, another silly thing, I can't believe a PhD here talked about. So basically, they're actually saying that faith can be a way of knowing things. And I've heard people say this, and I never thought that as a Christian, I would never say that. But this is one thing that Tango was trying to say. Okay, so. Since I have so much here, let me just see if there's anything. Okay, let's go on to the second from the last page. Okay, hold on. Okay. A couple more. Back one. About miracles. It was talking about miracles. Really, it was just about the resurrection. And I thought, you know what? We could just shortcut this whole presentation. I mean, can Pastor Nathan admit that the Gospels are anonymously written? This is something I didn't find out until even I left the Christian church. Nobody knows who really wrote it. So when you say Mark wrote this or Luke wrote this, it's really misleading. Nobody knows. The early church, at some point, ascribed these authors to it, but the text itself doesn't say. So I'd like to know during this debate if Pastor Nathan would admit the fact that there are unknown authors to the gospel. And so basically what they're trying to do in this chapter is consider this gospel something serious. It's like, why would you consider this serious and not Harry Potter or some other, you know, fictional work? So, anyway, we'll leave it at that. Okay.
Thank you, Bernie. Nathan?
Good evening. I promised Glenda, my wife, this afternoon that I was going to be kind to Bernie. And I've decided, listening to Bernie, after Charlie has admitted that he's only read the introduction of the 683 pages and half of the first chapter, I decided not to be kind to you, Bernie, but to be loving. Your presentation doesn't show at all that you've read this book. And if you look here at his abstract, where he says, can humans look at the evidence of the world, natural facts, and deduce the existence and nature of God from it? This book states so. It states just the opposite. And so these 680 pages, which are Bernie's choice, and I thank you, Bernie, for giving me this book during the holidays. It's a very expensive book, but I do recommend it to you. It is, on one level, a presentation of Western philosophy from Plato to the present. And on another level, it's a presentation of natural theology from Jewish, Christian, and Muslim scholarship. On another level, it is a brilliant and honest publication of articles written by 13 Christian philosophers, not two authors, as Bernie says on meetup.com. One of the questions that Bernie has floated for this discussion is, can we prove the existence of God from natural theology? The bottom line conclusion of this book that I've read is one that resonates with me. While natural theology is in no way an attempt to fill in the gaps of our collective knowledge by rashly inserting God, it does give the naturalist pause in his conclusion that God does not exist. It actually shows by reason serious flaws in naturalism. Naturalism, as J.P. Moreland, the editor of this book, puts it, is a philosophy. In our day, Moreland says, quote, versions of naturalism has multiplied like rabbits. Moreland's definition of naturalism is one that is readily espoused by naturalists. Quote, naturalism is the view that the spatial-temporal universe of entities postulated by our best current or ideal theories in the physical sciences, particularly physics, is all there is. Over the past several years of these forms, I have emphasized that all of the classical fields must work together to understand truth. Natural science, narrowly physics, cannot do the job alone. This book aptly shows the important role of philosophy. Speaking of philosophy, the honest, consistent, and brilliant philosopher Nietzsche summarized his nihilism with this assertion, quote, there are altogether no moral facts. Mark Linville writes in chapter 7 of this book, quoting G.K. Chesterton, who remarked, Nietzsche was unable to laugh, but could only sneer. Linville recounts Nietzsche heaping scorn on G. Eliot, the pen name for Mary Ann Evans, a woman who had rejected theistic belief but held fast to a sense of moral duty that she regarded as, quote, absolute. She argued that morality did not require a religious foundation. She declared her view to be a, quote, religion of humanity. Involving the expansion of the sense of human fellowship into the impulse strong enough to compel us to live for others, unquote. Nietzsche complained of her and her group. They are rid of the Christian God and now believe all the more firmly that they must cling to Christian morality. To place this in our local community, if you've been in the forum for the past 3.5, 4 years, Bernie is following G. Eliot and CFI of Portland President Sylvia Benner is following Nietzsche. Sylvia is consistently atheist and naturalist due to her commitment to a consistent philosophy, namely Nietzsche's nihilism. Bernie's view and practice is as faulty as G. Eliot, who inconsistently attempts to hold to atheism and naturalism, which cannot philosophically support any moral system, code, or behavior. So what does this have to do? Why is this in the book? What does this have to do with natural theology? Simply put, natural theology is a long-standing and diverse philosophical discussion that stands as a credible argument against nihilism. In other words, the God of Abraham, attested to by Jewish, Christians, and Muslim thinkers, is the only reason against nihilism. Having summarized for you the broadest stroke of the book, now let me just map it out so that you can maybe see, oh, maybe I will tackle the 683 pages. The contributors to this book understand mathematics, logic, natural science, philosophy, and theology. There are pages full of mathematical formulas and theorems and classical logical syllogisms with which they interact and supply very few of their own personal comments. It is really a historic view of what natural theology has done since Plato and Aristotle. And so to read their contributions is indeed daunting for most of us. As I sort of feel like I'm in my childhood, fundamentalist, Bible-thumping childhood with Bernie giving me this book. Like, I'm supposed to champion this book now, which I would just rather put it down here and commend you to the Bible. But see, this isn't about the Gospels and their authors tonight. It's about natural theology. But see, Bernie wants to pick at my Bible, so he's giving me this big book here. So, as you may know, the three classical proofs of God in natural theology are the cosmological argument, not a proof, an argument, the teleological argument, and the ontological argument. This book presents all three with related and supporting articles. Beginning with Plato and Aristotle, classic and Western philosophy has developed arguments for the existence of God without relying on special revelation. Charles Tully of Pharaoh begins chapter one with his definition of natural theology. It is the practice of philosophically reflecting on the existence and nature of God independent of real or apparent divine revelation or scripture. One of the gems in chapter one is Taliaferro's successful showing that the cosmological argument is both Platonic and Aristotelian. Theism cannot be confined to the Platonic world of idealism because Aristotle continued the cosmological argument in a world of materialism. Both are pagan Hellenists. They're not Christians. Most significantly, both are sound philosophers whose use of human reason and logic still informs the way we think today. In chapter two, William Lane Craig and James D. Sinclair define the cosmological argument. It is, quote, a family of arguments that seek to demonstrate the existence of a sufficient reason or first cause of the existence of the cosmos. In Muslim scholarship, the cosmological argument is known as the Kalam. The authors show how the German mathematician Hilbert, who gave to us Hilbert's hotel illustration in the 20th century, moved mathematicians to reconsider their concept of infinity in relation to infinite regress. Until Hawkins and Penrose in the 1970s, natural science dogmatically held to an actual infinitive, the belief that temporal, material events and objects regress into the past infinitely. Stephen Hawkins did not come up with the Big Bang, but he is the one with Penrose, his partner, who's substantiated it, leaving a few but significant exceptions to the theory. The Big Bang is a theory that marks the beginning of the universe and its expansion. Indeed, the expansion of the Big Bang has been successfully photographed and charted. And so the absolute infinite, the absolute infinite of non-personal materiality fell out of favor in natural science in the late 1970s. It's hard to believe that such a theory and its supporters like Stephen Hawkins have so quickly fallen out of favor now in the natural science community. The reason for this is that Hawkins has failed where quantum physics has arisen, especially string theory.
We've got about a minute.
Quantum physics has moved scientists to develop the multiverse theory. Have you heard about that? Bernie mentioned it as if it was one and the same with the Big Bang. But what has captured the attention of all the sciences is that prior to the Big Bang, there is apparently an infinite regress of universes and parallel universes. It's all going in the right direction if you're a theist. Infinite regress makes room for anything infinite. The Big Bang, with its new cousin, string theory, makes room for intelligent design at one moment in time. Thank God for quantum physics and string theory. Once again, the authors do not come close in this book to claiming that natural theology can prove the existence of a personal agent who is the first cause. However, natural theology, as it works with the unfolding natural sciences, contains to gain ground and arguments towards such a proof. The question any naturalist must ask is this: if natural science is discovering that infinity and agency are indeed part of the universe equation, then why is it that we deny a personality when it comes to infinity and agency? This is not simply a gap for theists. It's also a huge gaping hole for naturalists. Am I pretty close there?
Yeah.
I've got other summaries of the other chapters, but I'm out of time.
Okay.
So ask me about the other chapters.
By number?
By number.
Okay.
I'm sorry, Bernie. I just don't think you read the book.
So so now comes the time where we're the challenge is for me to ask questions about each of these gentlemen's presentations. So I'm gonna bite on Nathan Bernie's hook here. He was talking about the personality, the anonymity of the Gospels, and so I'm gonna ask Bernie to expand on that, why he says the Gospel.
I'm sorry, Mr. Moderator. I would really like to object to that, and I'll tell you why. The authorship of the Gospels is in the field of special revelation, and Bernie has chosen tonight that we would discuss natural theology, which is defined finding proofs in nature apart from special revelation. And we've been 4.5 years into this now, so I feel sort of it's like family. It's like, why are we talking about special revelation tonight? I don't get it, unless you want to do it during Q&A. But I came here, I invested the last 2 months seriously working in my tool shed, where I have a little space heater, reading this book and meticulously going through it, because I thought we were going to discuss natural theology.
Okay, well, just a little response on that. On a chapter of miracles, it talks specifically about the resurrection, and they're specifically talking about all the gospel accounts. So they're basically going into the gospel accounts hardcore. So it's germane to the discussion. It's perfectly legitimate.
Fine. I'm willing to answer any question. I'll answer any question. I just think that we should stick to natural theology. If you want, I can explain to you the chapter on the resurrection and why it's there.
That would be a good thing. Why don't we go on a question of natural theology?
In natural theology, back to Anselm in the 11th century, the three classic arguments are the cosmological, the teleological, and the ontological. The ontological argument, as natural theology has developed, has all the adherents to the practice of natural theology have agreed that the ontological argument only works in a closed system. And so, because this is a textbook on natural theology, there are historical articles on all of what has happened there. And in natural theology, in the ontological argument, if we are in a closed system, which we aren't tonight, so if a closed system would be the Christian system, it's a closed system. Or the naturalist system is a closed system, or whatever your system is. In the closed system of Christianity, some natural theologians have decided that they would try to take their scientific principles and philosophical theorems and put them onto the biblical text. And their argument has been that the textual criticism itself is a science, apart from determining whether it's natural science or not. I mean, whether it's special revelation or not. And so that's the argument. But the authors with the editors of this book readily agree that the ontological argument only works in a closed system. And so they do have a chapter on there about the resurrection. But no one practicing natural theology is trying to answer the question, did Jesus really rise from the dead? And why would God do it this way? Why is this central to the gospel message? The person practicing natural theology and what is in this chapter all has to do with textual criticism. So, who wrote the Gospels? Well, you could start with Wikipedia, and you could start with a Bible dictionary. You could see what the church has said, and the church has been very honest about which authors are historically attested to and which are not. But there is no treatment of it in connection to special revelation. The argument that, well, we don't know who the authors of the Gospels are, proves that this isn't special revelation. If anything, that would prove that it's special revelation. After all, if it's special revelation, what are we doing with any human authors to begin with, right? So this is somewhat of a tangential historical part of the book. And it's not bread and butter natural theology. That would be my answer.
So, Bernie, I've got a question for you. So, would you consider yourself a practitioner of natural theology, and why or why not?
I think this book basically, a lot of it comes down to two errors.
That's not my question. My question actually is not about the book, but whether you yourself are practicing natural theology.
Well, I don't practice theology because that's about belief in God, and I don't believe God exists. Just like Santa Claus doesn't exist. I don't have a Santa Clausology. I don't have a theology. I have a philosophy. Mm-hmm. And philosophy and theology have a big overlap because they both have opinions on the same thing.
So
I have a philosophy rather than a theology.
Okay, so the reason why I asked that question is because this afternoon when my son was asking me what the subject was, I said natural theology, and he said, "What the Sam Hill is that?" Well, not his exact words, but and so I gave as a definition for him. Well, natural theology is a study of the world around us and what we can learn about that as to whether God exists or does not exist, and if he exists, what he would be like. Mm-hmm. So
right. Yeah, I think that's kind of the project. I don't think they accomplished it.
Right, my only point of that is I would say you are practicing natural theology in that your philosophy is studying the natural world, mm-hmm. and you, based on the evidence you see in the natural world, you're concluding that there is not a God.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So,
you can say I have a natural theology. My theology is that God doesn't exist. You know, if you wanted to say that,
yeah.
I mean, it seems kind of strange.
My point is you're basing that on what you observe.
Right.
Okay.
Yes.
I have another question for you. And this is, can you explain the fact that if everything that exists is material and is the things that we can see, hear, feel, taste, and touch, and there is nothing else, let's say, I think that's a reasonably good definition of naturalism.
Well, there's a lot of things that exist that we can't smell or taste. I mean, there's certain gases like radon and stuff we can't smell.
But we can observe them. We can observe them with our senses and with
the... If we have the technology, I mean, we can't hear in this room, but if we had a device...
Yeah,
we,
yeah. Right. Right. But my question, but there are some things that are not part of the natural universe that, for example, angels and God and things like this. Mm-hmm. My question is, if our mind is also all composed of things in the natural world, how is it that our mind is able to actually discuss things that are outside the natural universe?
Yeah, the thing is that these supernatural ideas, like angels, they, you know, people see these. And so what happens is when the supernatural is said to interact with the natural world, it's going to leave a mark, basically. So sometimes people say, like, how come there's so many demon experiences and all that stuff back in the old days, but now we have video cameras, let's set them up, and we don't see anything. Of course, you know, on TV, they have the ghost chasers, which is a bunch of garbage, I think. But, yeah, how come it's like, you know, now that we have the technology, nothing shows up? We can record them, and so where's your story, you know?
So, let me see if I can rephrase my question.
Where's the haunted house? We can put cameras down. There's nothing there. There's no haunted houses.
My question is not discussing the existence of these things or not, but the puzzle that a mind which is composed only of protons and neutrons, mm-hmm. and electrons is able to actually conceive and discuss and talk about things,
right.
that don't exist.
Yeah, but see, the point is the supernatural is set to interact with the world. Like, you know, for example, if there really was a flood, it would leave a mark. You know, if there really was an Adam and Eve that were the first humans, it would leave a mark in the DNA record. These things, when you say the gods interact with the world, it's going to leave a mark, and there's no marks. There's no good marks. And that's why this book, for example, where's it reaching for evidence? Into the unknowns, into the gaps. Oh, here's something we don't know about. Okay, let's plug God into there. They don't use the things we do know about. There's nothing in there about DNA. fossil record, geology, nothing.
Okay, well, I'm going to leave it at that, and we're going to go. But I'm going to make a slight aside here. My slight aside is going to be, I tried to ask Bernie a question, and he didn't quite. I don't think he quite understood my question, and I asked it a second time. And I'm going to not banter him. I'm not going to pester him. And I'm hoping that when it comes to Q&A time, that you folks there, when you ask a question, and you are not successful in making the person understand your question the way you wanted it understood, that you would also, actually I'd ask that you be even a little more understanding than I am and backing off. But, yeah, anyway, enough of my thing. So now we come to the time when it's going to be Nathan asking Bernie and Bernie asking Nathan, and do we flip a coin or know who's going to ask who first? Or?
No, do you want to go first, Nathan? I can go first if you want me to.
Sure, go ahead.
Okay, so we have 10 minutes each?
10 minutes each, yeah.
Okay. Now, the idea here, too, before we start the timer, the idea is that I could ask Nathan questions, and he's not supposed to respond with a sermon. It's supposed to be interactive, and I'm in the driver's seat. Then when he has his chance, he can be in the driver's seat. So he can feel free to interrupt. And
I'll do my best. I mean, I'm used to giving sermons. So.
And also, when it's our turn, we shouldn't give a sermon either. We're supposed to ask the other person a question, okay? All right, so ready?
Go ahead.
Okay. You said, let's see. Well, I wonder, for this natural theology, could you even give one piece of evidence that is not God of the Gaps argument or an argument from ignorance? The argument from ignorance is a fallacy where it says, like, well, I believe God made the Big Bang. And I say, I don't think so. And they go, well, can you just prove it? No. Okay, therefore my argument stands. Because we don't know, they're saying that's evidence for God. So can you give any kind of evidence that doesn't fall into something like that?
Well, what these authors are Christian philosophers. And what they're doing is they are giving a historic survey of natural theology. And what Anselm and Aquinas, back in the 11th and 12th centuries, what they pinpointed was this problem of infinity, infinite regress and first cause. And how do these two things go together? We think that these are relatively new ideas, but natural science is just simply digging up what philosophers have been identifying for centuries now.
Okay, so, hold on a second. So yeah. That's basically God of the Gaps argument. We don't know. That's the mystery stuff. Nobody knows, even quantum mechanics, nobody knows what's in a black hole. We can't go beyond what they call the event horizon. This is all right. Theory stuff. There's nothing there.
It's not theory. This is what's going on, Bernie. All of us have to deal with let's say natural scientists have to deal with phenomenon and have to deal with inference and explanation. And for most of us, we convolute all of these things. But since those of us who are on the street, if we're street-level naturalists, atheists, or street-level Christians, we're mostly interested in explanations. That's why probably this book is going to be difficult for most of us, because it talks a lot about the phenomenon and the history of charting the phenomenon. But see, I think when you talk, I hear you convoluting phenomenon, inference, and explanations. If you can keep those three and see how it's really inescapable for us to deal with brute facts.
Well, I'm just asking, I mean, just, is there any evidence? Is there any evidence for God that's not God of the Gaps? What evidence is there for God?
Well, when you say God of the Gaps, I'm assuming that you're talking about the gap problem that philosophy talks about quite a bit. And the gap problem is every time we don't know what to do with the phenomena before us, then through inference, we try to fill in what we don't know. And then we offer to people an explanation. Now, this is what occurs in every field, not only in philosophy or theology. This happens in natural science. That's why I said in my opening presentation that it's not only a problem for theists, these gaps, what we do not know. It's truly a problem for the natural scientist. And that's why we get from natural science today so many explanations.
Well, is there any evidence, though? Is there any hard evidence for God? You know, beyond the philosophy, you know, the philosophical arguments for it, which I am considering are God of the gaps because it's appealing to things that we don't know yet. Is there anything you can appeal to what we do know? Is there any evidence? The DNA record, for example, fossil record, anything. Is there any evidence for God? Has anybody demonstrated miracles can happen when they pray? You know, like Benny Hinn, he's a faker. He does crusades all the time. What evidence is there?
Yeah, so natural theology isn't providing you evidence. It is looking at phenomenon, it's making inferences, and it's giving explanations. This is what happens. We do not live in this two-dimensional world. We don't live in a petri dish. Natural scientists, biologists, any kind of a natural scientist sees a little bit of phenomenon,
Okay. Makes
inferences, and then offers explanations. It's inescapable.
Okay, so do I have more time?
Yep.
Okay, so...
You got about 5 more minutes.
Okay, good. So you said that atheism leads to nihilism, which means everything's dark, there's no point in living, you might as well go kill yourself, right?
That's a street-level definition for nihilism.
Okay, so I think just because there is no ultimate, there is no transcendent meaning, I also see that you can look at atheism as a very liberating thing, where you can go out and live your life however you want to, the way you best, instead of being wasting time like, what is God's will for my life? I don't know, and I have to ask all these people and pray, and I can't get an answer, and just struggling over that. It's like, wow, I could actually just choose what I want, make my own path.
Well, why
is that dark?
Since we're talking about natural theology, and which is in the field of philosophy, I just appeal to the greatest atheist philosopher of all time, Nietzsche.
Well,
and that's why he was included in the book. Nietzsche consistently, and it's just not because he was melancholy, that things in his life didn't work out, that he was sick and his bones were aching on the Swiss lake.
Let's not talk about certain people. I'm trying to talk to you about atheism, okay? I mean, I could point to some Christian guy and say, look at Benny Hinn, how ridiculous is that's Christianity for you. It's not about Benny Hinn, it's about the ideas, and you're saying...
So why did you mention Benny Hinn and you did last time we were together?
Because I'm...
And before that, you always, Benny Hinn.
Right, well, so I have
Nietzsche,
a whole slide, I'm sorry.
Nietzsche.
I know.
Nietzsche.
I have my couple slides too, but we didn't have time for that. So, my point is though, why...
I'll tell the difference.
Do you think that atheism cannot be positive?
It's not consistent. Let me tell you why. Okay, listen, the difference is Benny Hinn is way out over here.
I don't want to talk about people though.
I know you don't.
I'm talking about your claim that atheism is depressing.
Well, what I want to say about Nietzsche, who was a real person, and I know you don't want to talk
about real
persons, because you don't want to talk about personality at all.
No, he's not my role model. He's not somebody I look up to.
But he is... He is the atheist philosopher who put forth, and most atheists on the planet are trying to backpedal from this, but he's the one who consistently, he looks at the phenomenon, he infers no morality. He explains to you, go out and live however you want.
Okay, but
that's the magic, that's the brilliant, that's the carrot of atheism.
Nathan, you're answering a different question than what I'm asking. I want to talk about atheism.
It can't be positive.
Why not?
Because I'm positive.
I have a positive outlook and I'm an atheist.
Actually, you're not positive, Bernie. No, you've got a facade. You don't have an inner joy that exudes. You want it so badly, but you thought you could get it in Christianity, and then you went cold on that.
Well, let me tell you.
You don't have the joy and the sparkle that I see in those who belong to Jesus.
I used to have a joy and a sparkle about living forever and having a relationship with Jesus and all that, and now I see it as a delusion, something that's not real.
Right, because you know, just like a
child could be very happy about believing in Santa Claus and all the presents they're going to get, and then later on they see Santa Claus is not real, they're not going to have that joy about Santa Claus. But they have a different kind of joy because they're being sober and they're living in reality.
Yeah, this world, one place in this book where any atheist, any naturalist reading it would just like glob right on is the argument from evil. Because there we have all sorts of common ground. With our naturalist neighbors and friends, we all agree that this world is dark, that it's full of horrible, cruel, evil things.
Okay, but hold on, it's my turn to ask you questions.
Okay, but
do I still have one time?
I didn't give you a sermon on evil. I was just telling you that's where we agree. And so if you don't have God, Bernie, and you have this dark, evil world, are you really going to whistle?
Well, you have the dark, evil world no matter what.
But I have God, you see.
It doesn't help. I mean, it might make you feel better, but it's not going to cure your cancer if you're diagnosed with cancer.
So you're proving the point that Nietzsche said. Without God, it is hopeless. My bones are aching on the Swiss lake. I should just put an end to this, but you know what? I sort of like being miserable. And by the way, don't you ever give me even one commandment, less than 10. And anyone who does that is just a foolish atheist.
Sorry, I didn't really follow that, but anyway.
Well, I thought it was pretty good.
Okay, your turn, Nathan. Questions for Bernie.
Oh my. So, Bernie, if I ask you a question, well, let me see here. I've got a question that comes out of the book. Do you think there's more than one credible answer to why is the kettle boiling? If you came into my home and you hear the whistle of the tea kettle and you ask me why is the kettle boiling?
Yeah, I understand you can give it an explanation scientifically why it's boiling.
Right.
You could also give it an explanation as to why did somebody do it, like they're making tea, you know, like there's a purpose behind it, yes.
Okay, so, you know, I could say, well, the heat of the flame is being conducted via the copper bottom of the kettle to the water, increasing the kinetic energy of the water molecules, such that they vibrate so violently that they break the surface tension of the water and are thrown off in the form of steam. Now, if you were in my home, you probably would like that answer, maybe. I don't know if you talk to your family that way, but if I talk to my family that way, they might not appreciate it all the time.
Well, I think it depends on the context. I mean, if your kid is saying, wow, why is the water boiling? You know, they don't want to know that you're making tea. They want to know, technically, why are there bubbles in the water? So they would like that kind of an answer, but, you know.
Yeah.
It depends on the context.
But you'd be okay if you asked me, why is the tea kettle boiling? And I said, I put the kettle on to make a cup of tea. Would you like some?
It depends on the context, you know.
Right.
Like I said, if I was trying to have a scientific discussion with you, then I would not like that answer.
So then my question is, to what degree should you and I make investments in reading the context that we're in, and studying the context, and understanding whether it's a context in the ancient past, or if it's a present social context?
Mm-hmm.
How important is it that we try to listen and communicate to each other in the specific context, or understand what the dialogue was in a past context?
Exactly, it's extremely critical.
Okay.
It's vital.
See, because when you and I counterpoint, when we talk, I don't think that you really get that much. I think that you have an ideal context in your mind, and that the only thing that suffices for you is a scientific answer, even if you may not understand it. So I don't know if you get what's at the heart of natural theology and any kind of scientific inquiry or philosophical question. It comes down to personhood. It comes down to circularity. It comes down to the circularity problem and the personality problem. And I just don't get that from you.
You're supposed to be asking questions now.
Yeah.
Yeah, so go.
That was sort of a way to get a response.
Okay.
In my viewpoint, what is the point of natural theology? I think basically it's a defense where somebody could say, you know, religion is all nonsense. You know, it's all make-believe. And so somebody might say, like, okay, well, let's have a reasonable response. And that's what natural theology is. It's supposed to be a reasonable response. That's the way I see it. And I just think that philosophy fails on it, that's all.
Right, so there's quite a bit in this particular book that you chose, using logical syllogisms. Were you able to follow any of that in the book, and can you help me with that?
Well, we have to talk about a specific one. We'd have to open it up and look at it.
Right, so, I mean, these really go beyond my pay grade and my understanding. But I'm willing to, is this my book?
It's your book.
Okay.
There's a lot of different varieties of them, and, you know, there are different complexities for different arguments.
Right. So, let me just get one that I highlighted here.
It was not the page and a half one you showed me this afternoon, Nathan.
No, I thought maybe I would put up on the overhead for you to see some of these, but...
So are you like thinking about the Bayesian ones with all the calculations?
No, I'm going to let those go. There's just some classic syllogisms here that...
Brief.
Well, maybe I should not waste our time this way.
Yeah, I think the book's too verbose to try to find something.
Well, yeah. Let me just, to back to these questions then, if you understand that context is important, can you explain to me why it is that you seem to scorn, you seem to sneer at contexts that are willing to give a personal relational answer?
I just think the arguments have, like, for example, there's fallacies, like the God of the gaps kind of thinking, and the other one is the argument from ignorance. There's a whole bunch of logical fallacies that people can use. You basically, when you do deductive reasoning, you have a premise, and you go to a conclusion. And sometimes people use logical fallacies to get there. And so I think one of the big fallacies used over and over again is called this argument of ignorance. That's one of them. There's some other ones too.
Okay. Do you believe in brute facts?
Yeah.
Okay. Can you explain to me why it is that you believe in brute facts?
Well, do you want to give an example of what that is?
Well, as I understand it, a brute fact stands alone, and without any kind of prior human thought or consideration of it, it remains true. And without any inference or explanation about it, it is there, and I can see it without any prior thought or any following conclusion. I can readily see that it's a brute fact.
So are we talking about something like Chad is sitting in that chair?
Yeah, or like I exist, we exist, that might be a brute fact. Let's try to get like a brute fact.
Well,
like
let's
I
do
exist.
Something much more simpler, because there's too much philosophy there. There's too much existentialism there. How about just taking that hymnal that's sitting right there in that chair?
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah, so we could say, yeah, we could call that a brute fact without trying to prove
it. Well, the fact would be that there's a hymnal on that chair.
Mm-hmm. Right. We can take that as a brute fact. Right. It may not be there, but it may be a dream. This may not be real. There's all these other things, but we're not going to go there. We're just going to say it's a brute fact. And so we say, that's a brute fact, and let's use that to...
Yeah, see, actually, that's not how I understand brute fact. I'm not talking about the existence of it. I'm talking about how I can make a propositional statement about it. And is my propositional statement about it a brute fact?
I think just saying that it exists is a brute fact.
But I didn't say that it existed, did I?
Well, if you say it's green, that's a brute fact. I mean, I'm not
that
sure
would be easier for me. Yeah, yeah. So, when you see that there, does a thought come into your mind?
Sure.
And look at that there, and what may be a thought that comes into your mind?
That it's a book, it's got white pages.
Right. And you don't know it's a hymnal, perhaps, right?
Right.
Right. But I do, and why would I know that that's a hymnal?
From experience.
Right. So I have some prior thoughts, and I even have prior experience, which means that I come up with a proposition that is significantly different than yours.
Right. Because you have a different fact base, yes.
Right. Mm-hmm. So when I say there's a green hymnal sitting on that chair there, is that a brute fact?
Is that a brute fact?
So is your point, Nathan, the fact that there's difference between you're saying there is a green book on that chair, which does not require prior knowledge, but to say there's a green hymnal on that chair requires some prior knowledge to know that it's
actually I'm trying to find a way to find out if Bernie really believes in brute facts, in independent existing facts apart from anything I think, perceive, experience, or anything that I infer, explain, or conclude. That's what I'm asking.
Well, I think all facts come from experience. You can't know, I mean, in order to have a fact, you have to know about it. So
when we now cook this up to infinity, and we start talking about infinite regress, then we have no experience after a certain point.
We have no experience.
That's right. And we have, at a certain point with infinite regress, we even lose observation,
you know what?
And we even lose thought.
The thing about an infinite regress, usually they say, because of that, there must be a time zero, or when time started, the Big Bang. I don't have a problem with that. I think with multiverse theory, you still have that. Time could have been created with multiverse theory. So I don't see a negative regress as a problem.
Okay, well, we've had Bernie for 10 minutes and Nathan for 10 minutes. And now it is your turn it is now 7:35. We've got just under an hour for audience Q&A. And let me just state some ground rules here. You're free to ask one question that would be addressed to both speakers. You could ask a question addressed to just one speaker, in which case then we'd give the other speaker a chance to talk about it. We would ask that you ask a question rather than make a sermon. If you want to make a sermon, you can talk to Nathan afterwards and see.
I'll help you with your sermon.
Yeah, you won't do it anyway. But make a question. A certain amount of dialogue is fine, but we want to make sure that everybody has a chance. So at some point in time, I will probably cut somebody off, and please don't be offended when I do. I'm trying to make sure that everybody has a chance. I'm going to try to make sure, to the best of my ability, that we only ask, that no one asks a second question until everyone that wants to has had a chance to ask a first question. I'd also caution you that we are dealing with things that matter a great deal about, that we care a great deal about. That's one of the things that why I really like these presentations, because although Bernie and Nathan don't agree on many things, they do both agree on the fact that these are important things to discuss. And when we discuss things that are important, sometimes we get wrapped up into it and we can get emotional. And if you feel like you're just a little bit over the limit, it might be a good time to take a bathroom break. That's fine. I mean, nobody's keeping.
You might have to go on the porch and have a smoke with me.
There you go.
I need one right now.
So all of these things work. But anyway, so one last thing about questions. The subject tonight is natural theology, and so we would it'd be better, and thank you, Nathan, for pulling me up short there, but we would like to have that be the focus. That doesn't mean that other questions are out, but if you're contemplating two questions and one of them relates more clearly to natural theology, then I'd ask you to prefer that question to the other one. So and you're also allowed to ask the narrator a question, but I can always say, I think I'll ask this guy for this guy. Anyway, so who would like to ask the first question? Yes, sir.
Should I just speak like this?
You can speak like that. You can speak up. That would be wonderful.
Okay, great. I have a question and then a little bit of an illustrative example. So this goes to Bernie. If miracles did exist, just take it as assumption, how would we have scientific evidence for them, granted that miracles were by their nature not repeatable? So the example I have is an emotional example of the 1979 St. Valentine's Day monopole. So it's well known back in physics that there cannot be many monopoles. But in 1979, three separate observers picked up the existence of a magnetic monopole. Now, since the theory says they don't exist, and we couldn't repeat this, this was dismissed out of hand. But it could have been a miracle. And we had three separate observable facts. So I'm saying is, even if miracles did exist and we observed them, the nature of the scientific question itself would dismiss them because they're not by their nature repeatable.
Well, I would say, first of all, I don't know what a monopole is. I've never heard that before, so I'll do internet research after this.
Okay, because so granted, it's a scientific impossibility.
Okay. But I guess what your question is implying that miracles are probably rare and probably are not going to be repeatable, which, you know, I don't know if you can get Christians to agree to that or not. I mean, does God react or not when you pray?
But if they happen, then even if they did happen, assuming that, science could not verify that they did happen.
Well, I don't know about that. I mean, if you turn water into wine here, you can get, if you could do that, you would get $1 million from the James Randi Foundation. He has, you know, $1 million for anybody who can do anything that you can do that you say is supernatural. And there's a lot of people that claim it. They claim they can read minds, they can do ESP, they can tell the future. But when they're under test, sometimes they say, oh, well, my magical powers aren't working now because I'm being tested or somebody's looking at me or something.
But notice in the James Randi example, that he requires it to be repeatable. If you were to say water turned into wine in a non-repeatable fashion, James Randi would throw that out as being unacceptable evidence.
Well, these guys can do their performance on a stage, and they can do it for callers who call in and pay by the minute, but they can't do it when he's looking.
Okay, well, I've taken up enough time. Okay,
thank you.
Respond.
Next question. Hey, next. Yes, sir.
Yeah, sure. So I'm actually a physics student, so I could answer the monopole if you guys are interested.
We could sign you up for next month.
Yeah. So also, I want to talk about the multiverse theory. That's kind of a fringe theory, and I'd appreciate it if we kind of got off of that a little bit, because it's not. In 1957, Hugh Everett III came up with the many worlds interpretation, and it wasn't accepted until Stephen Hawking jumped onto that camp, but it's still not widely accepted. So. But anyways, my question is for you, Pastor Nathan, and my question is about the infinities. So you were saying that there's always infinities that we've been trying to solve. And I wanted to ask, so what was the first one that in the book was offered as the first infinity that science had an issue with or that man tried to overcome or something like that? Because
the discussion for a good long time, like back to Plato.
Right.
So all of Western philosophy has been aware of the concept of infinity.
No, so I'm looking for a specific infinity. So we mentioned the cosmological background. That was an infinity, and then we found the beginning. So it kind of goes to the God of the Gaps argument. We once believed Zeus was, you know, up on Mount Olympus because we couldn't get there, right? That was an infinity. Then he moved up into the sky. Then he moved into, you know, now he's ephemeral, you know, we can't see him at all. I'm just wondering, we keep tackling these infinities. Are there any specific infinities that are offered?
Well, the one that is highlighted in the book has to do with Hawking's and Penrose in the 1970s.
Okay.
Saying, we have found a moment in time from which the universe expanded. And so the two men said that in a dogmatic natural science context of infinite regress, that material events and objects have always moved back in the past, connected to each other, and on and on and on, beyond our observation. And then now Stephen Hawking and his partner say, we actually have the inception of the universe. And so the multiverse theory is not the multiverse theory isn't coming out of theology. It's not coming out of philosophy.
Out of quantum mechanics, yeah.
Yeah, it's coming out of a natural science. It's coming from, mostly from the naturalist camp in natural science. And it is the way natural science has treated someone like Hawkins in our day is rather unkind. I mean, he's basically been thrown off the bus. He has had to admit in the scientific community that the exceptions that he listed in his, quote, Big Bang theory were so flawed that the new research from quantum physics has led to this theory. As you say, it is a fringe theory that there are parallel universes. So it's not that we shouldn't think of infinity anymore linearly, because quantum physics is showing us that everything is circular. So back to philosophy, why are we afraid of circularity in philosophy when now we see that the universe expands from a core, and all universes do, from a core, and they thin out at their edges, you see? So all of a sudden now we have to have different images in our mind about reality. And Hawkins has been very kind in the way he's been treated here. He's had to hop on the multiverse bus, which is, you know, like Bernie says, I have no problem with reconciling the Big Bang with the multiverse. My point, having read the book, so it's the book's point, is, isn't it interesting that these theologians in the 11th and 12th century were grappling with infinite regress and absolute infinity as a first cause and how to reconcile these things?
But their infinities were the Earth and nature, right? They didn't even know what stars were. They didn't even know
now, about... How does that change anything? I mean, with all due respect to you, how does the argument change or reality change if you have one small circle here, and then as we pull back the lens, we see, oh, it's a bit larger. Nothing changes. The principles are the same, and you know that. What does a natural scientist do? He brings it down. The only way you can do it is to get rid of everything and bring it down.
Exactly.
So please, think about circles, not lines.
No, you're exactly right. We've expanded our circle of knowledge, and we keep going further and further out. But the answer for beyond that edge is still God. So it's still the God of the gaps there. Like, that's exactly my point. And so you keep tackling the infinities and pushing him further and further back.
So is your point that if when I am in the middle of the Great Plains and I can only see whatever it is that you can see to the horizon, okay, 6 miles, and I say, well, God is at 7 miles, and so I build a tower, and so then I say God is 10 miles out, and I build a taller mile, and so if that is all there is to God, then you would say that therefore there is no God.
Exactly, because soon I'm hearing here, but we could potentially know even more, and even more, and then even more.
My point as a mathematician would be that, in fact, if you're standing on the plane and you think that infinity is just beyond what you can see, then in fact you have a very, very small concept of infinity.
This is a very important part of what is being summarized in this book. Okay. And that is, the Big Bang wasn't thrown out when the multiverse brought back, reprised infinite regress.
Right.
Now what we're doing in natural science is trying to come to terms with the fact that both are reality. That we can have a first cause someplace in the middle or along the way in the infinite regress. So no, God isn't always at the end of the infinite regress. It is possible. The only thing that's being debated now is whether or not the first cause is a personality. Because unless you want to completely kick Hawkins off the bus, do you want to kick him completely off the bus?
Well, so what he became famous for was actually his black hole theory. Hawking radiation. If you guys look that up on Wikipedia, it's pretty cool. But anyways, he proved that black holes actually evaporate. And that's the reason why people claim him as a genius, is because he's a genius for quantum gravity and quantum field theory. But when it comes to those things, you're right, he's jumping on the bus, but what is science but building from foundation up? And, you know, sometimes we take a step down and make a wrong guess, but...
Right, so remember that too when you're reading the Bible, that there are things being built and there's a progression. And don't point back to Moses and say, what a dumb guy.
Oh, no, it's definitely...
Yeah, just remember that there's, in human development, there is always an unfolding and they're standing on shoulders. So,
right. So yeah, science came out of its natural philosophy, actually. That was the moderator. When you're asking him about natural theology, so natural philosophy, that was the original term for science. We were philosophizing, no, I don't know the word. But anyways, about what is nature, right? What are these things that these are made of, right? And so we were theorizing about these things, but then we tested them and found out that, oh, actually we're a little bit wrong, so we're gonna improve that. So that's what science came out of.
Let's move on to somebody else now.
Just make a quick comment. I just wanna make two quick comments.
Okay.
One is, I just wanted to make sure that people don't think that multiverse theory is something that atheists are coming up with because they don't want to believe that God created the universe. For example, there's a Christian university, Baylor University, and when I was a Christian, I went to a Christian conference there and met one of the guys who's a scientist doing research in physics on multiverse theory. He believes in multiverse theory because he's doing string theory, leading edge physics. Which is yet to be proven, but you know, he was very convinced about it, and he was an evangelical Christian. So I want to make it clear that multiverse theory is not just for atheists. The other thing, too, there was a comment about multiverse theory might be a fringe idea. Maybe they're all fringe ideas as far as saying where did everything come from. Nobody knows. This is just something nobody knows about. There is no consensus like, oh, the consensus is that God created things at the Big Bang. That's not a consensus, you know? So Alex Valentin is one of the guys who's on the forefront of a lot of this stuff, and you know, I heard a Christian one time say that he didn't, go for this multiverse theory, but then I saw a video, and he has written a book. He does consider multiverse theory a valid hypothesis, so it's not really like I would want to say it's a fringe thing that only kooks, kind of believe in kind of thing.
Okay, Chad, and then after Chad, I'll get you, Richard. Chad,
okay.
What's your question?
This is for Nathan. Okay, so there's two theories why God was made up by the human mind. One, back in the ancient times, people heard thunder, they didn't know what it was, so then they said God did it, God of the gap, sort of. So then, number two, people evolved and survived the fittest, so they did not want to die. So then they invented God in the heaven so they would not have to die. Do you agree with these? Why or why not?
Well, what I do know is that humanity is prone to superstition, and humanity is also creative and comes up with colorful stories and explanations. So we're back to looking at the phenomenon, making inferences, and offering explanations. And when we find that people have gone through that, or a group has gone through that process, and what they explain is not sufficient for us, it's not satisfactory, why then we can say, by human reason, that's just not a good explanation. So you've brought up two, which are, for me, believable scenarios, not only in the ancient past, but I could imagine groups of people right now in the 21st century in different places in the world saying these kinds of things. And one of the reasons I believe that is that I've heard such ridiculous ideas right here in the Portland metro area,
okay,
just in the last few years. And so, they come from all different cultures and different backgrounds and different worldviews. So this isn't something that just theists have struggled with. The whole human race struggles with this. And that's why I think it's really important for us to remember the process of reason, the process of research, the process of offering explanations. By the way, last 2 weeks ago, when you asked me about Noah's Ark, a friend of your dad's took a part of your dad's video and slandered me on the internet and said another dumb Christian pastor gets shown up by a 11-year-old boy or something. And I know you didn't have anything to do with that, but the problem with that is the best part of my answer was cut out. So wherever you are right now, don't do it again. Take my whole answer.
Well,
let me interrupt there. I posted that video, that excerpt, and it seemed to me it was a total, there was nothing out of context.
Well, Bernie, that was a low shot. That was a low shot. Okay. The title was a low shot. And the soundbite was low, but I forgive you.
Well, the title was just sixth grade atheist asked pastor about Noah's Ark.
Go back and look at what you titled everything on that. And go back and see what you left out. Go back to the whole uncut version and see what you left out.
Okay?
Don't soundbite me. I'm your friend.
Okay.
Don't do that to me, okay?
Okay.
And you know what? For 3-4 days after that, I really felt badly about myself. I felt like a dumbass.
Okay, well,
the other thing to keep in mind too, Nathan, is that it very well may have been that someone could look at your presentation and think, you know, as they're cutting it, they could have been cherry picking and looking at the pieces and say, you know, I'm going to pick the pieces that make him look the most ridiculous. But they could also have been trying. They could have also, in very very well meaning, they could have picked out what they thought were your best points. But because they're coming at it from a different grid, they may not have had a clue what your best points.
Well, let me just say
that's helpful, Charlie. Right now, I really am hurt. I'm personally hurt. But I'll think about that. That's very helpful what you said.
Okay, I just want to say something about the charge of about a context. But if you look at the video, it actually goes on to, at the very end, you can see the next topic of starting is about Adam and Eve. So I did that purposely to show you that that was the end of that discussion. The whole question and the whole response is there without a cut. And the title is not inflammatory.
Well, Chad, the best part of my answer that was cut out, I didn't know it was your dad, I thought it was his friend. But the best part that was cut out is a matter of perspective. I was asking you to think about Noah and his personal perspective, and what is being described is from his perspective, not from a macro scientific assessment of what happened during the universal flood. So in other words, when you were asking me about the language of the Noahic story, I was trying to explain to you that what is in the Bible is Noah's firsthand description from the deck of the ark, or ground floor. Okay? That's the best answer that I have. Okay. Not the first stuff that was soundbited out.
I just want to clarify though. If you look at it, there was no. I don't like the charge that I did a soundbite because it was not a soundbite. You can look at the time of it and compare it to the original because the original is also on there. So it's a false charge to say I took a time.
Okay.
I took a time out, and also that I have a slanderous title because neither one of those charges are valid.
Okay.
Well, I think we both need to. We need to look at that afterwards.
So. Yeah.
Let's go on to Richard's question.
Well, the comment about cherry picking is kind of on theme here, and I don't know quite how to ask the question.
Doesn't stop us from asking questions.
No, it doesn't stop me from talking if I don't know what I'm talking about. I think, you know, in these kinds of discussion, if an atheist brings up something that says, Augustine said, St. Aquinas, I kind of said. Luther said. Calvin said. Certain popes said. Now, maybe the context of the discussion wouldn't allow that, but I think most Christians, thinkers, would feel that they needed to say something about that. And if Augustine or Aquinas or whoever was wrong, need to explain how they got it wrong. Now, I know some evangelicals would say, well, they really didn't know Jesus, you know. They didn't have a salvation experience, you know. And so we don't have to own them. But we kind of have to own these people. And so we have to explain where they went wrong.
Now you're going to get to your question soon.
So the Nietzsche thing is part of this. I mean, he is such an exemplar of thoroughgoing, consistent, push everything to its limits, atheism. And he has the nihilistic part of that. You know, that's a consequence. And that's a strong tradition in atheism. You know, it's not just some minor offshoot. I would think that as an atheist, you need to explain to us where Nietzsche was wrong and how he got it wrong and why you're right.
I wouldn't have any problem trying to explain that. You have to give me a specific question. What specifically did he say that you want me to explain?
His nihilism. And his that this is a consequence of an atheistic belief. This is the conclusion where you have to come to.
So let me see if I can rephrase it for you, Richard. I think what you're saying, what Nathan referred to is, and I'm not an expert on Nietzsche, but what it seems to me you're saying is, Nietzsche started with the premise of atheism, or concluded atheism, and then his further conclusion was hopelessness and darkness. So Bernie is maintaining that atheism is not hopeless and dark, but it's a positive thing. So you're asking Bernie to explain how it is that Nietzsche got it wrong.
Yes, I think you pay attention to the best thinkers in your field.
Okay.
My response would be is I would actually like to look at, we would have to have his actual text to look at, because I don't really want to respond to what you think he said. Because one thing that really irritates me is I've been in the debates where I've said things, and I've heard somebody else say, like, oh, Bernie said this and that. It's like, I never said that. That's making me look dumb and stuff like that. I mean, I never said that. I wouldn't even agree to that. So I don't really want to respond to what you think Nietzsche said. I would like to respond to exact text, but we can't do that unless you happen to have his text. I don't want to talk about a representation of that. Maybe what you thought he said. Sometimes I thought people said things, and I looked it up later, and I thought, oh, that's not exactly what he meant, or that's how he said it. So I think, to be fair, we'd have to look at the exact text, and I can imagine that some of it I would agree with, and some I would disagree with.
Would you give Nietzsche any additional credence or any additional slack because of his position in the atheist tradition and his importance there? Would you say, if Nietzsche says this, boy, I've really got to think this carefully through, as opposed to me?
I don't know. I would. Just on the sake of authority alone, it does not impress me. I mean, for example, one of the new atheists I wasn't all that impressed with was Christopher Hitchens. You know, he has his book, God is Not Great, While Religion Spoils Everything. And I thought that was idiotic. Religion spoils everything. And I hear other atheists saying that. I mean, personally, I think it's idiotic. So you could say, well, Christopher Hitchens is a standard in the new atheism movement. Shouldn't you try to defend him? His authority doesn't mean anything to me. I want to know why he's saying things. What's his logic? So the same thing with Nietzsche, I would say, let's look at his logic and see what we agree and disagree with.
For Bernie, I think you're getting at it there. What Richard is not saying, I'm not asking you to necessarily agree with somebody because they're an exemplar of atheism, but if they are on the mainstream and you disagree, then he's asking that you ought to interact with that and explain. You know, just in the same way that we as Christians would look back and we would see some people in our particular Christian tradition that we think got it wrong in some place, and we bear some sort of responsibility to say, well, this is why we, like, for example, my son asked me quite pointedly sometime, and he said he couldn't understand how any Christian could possibly have lived in the American South, antebellum South, and call themselves a Christian and own slaves. I think that's something that Christians something that Christians have to. The Christians either have to say, yes, we agree with them, or no, we disagree with them, and this is how we think they got it wrong.
I think the question has to do with authority, though, since he's like an authoritative figure in atheism. When I appreciate that, and it's like, well, you could say the same thing for Christianity. Would Pastor Nathan appreciate what the Pope says? I mean, he's a leader in the Christian faith, too. But it's like
that is actually part of the question, although not this direct one. is that Christians have authorities, and so we, you know, feel that they we need to interact with them. Atheism doesn't seem to have any authorities, and so whatever any other atheist said, that's it. You know, that's not my atheism.
There's no authority for all Christians, though.
Well, but there's more of an authority than there is in
certain traditions.
I don't agree with that. I mean, I learn from it. I don't care if they're Pope. I mean, the Pope could say things I could learn from. I listen to William Lane Craig's podcast. I listen to Christian apologists. Reasons to Believe, I listen to their podcast. I learn from things. I appreciate them. It doesn't bother me that they're Christian. I like their insight on certain things. And I just disagree with some of their conclusions.
Okay, let's go on to see if there's somebody else that has a question. All right, Mom, you've got the floor.
Okay, this isn't quite a question as you would think of it. I got my first classes in the seventh grade. They didn't give eye tests when I started to school. I have a wandering eye. And I used to entertain myself in school when it got dull by blinking and putting the teacher's nose on her mouth in what I saw. And this is what I think we're doing here tonight. We're each looking at it in our own way and assigning the other side someplace way off. And I think we've got to step back and start thinking and think our questions through before we ask them.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Larmel. Yeah, I would, because I'm a presuppositionalist, I really like what you've said. A lot of this is a matter of perspective. It most certainly is. I would, I don't know what else to say, Laura Bell.
Bernie, you want to react to that?
No, I'm not going to squint at anybody and put their nose on their head.
I want to say, my mom has lots of stories, and I was fully expecting she was going to recite a story I'd heard 20 times before, but I have never heard this before. Anyway, another question. Yes, sir.
Read the book, but the way I understand...
That's all right. It was not a requirement to... We did not ask you to sign a statement. I've read the book before we gave you pizza tonight.
What I understand from natural theology is the way to observe the nature to prove or disprove the existence of God. Now, the word God is quite complex for me and at times vague. What my question is, and the question is addressed to both, so to Pastor Nathan, it would be, okay, so observing nature, how do you define the God that exists? And to Bernie, it would be, how do you define, looking at the nature, how do you define the God that doesn't exist?
It's a good thing you didn't ask the questions the other way around.
Yeah, so natural theology is a field that is wide in its practitioners. There are ancient pagans to Jewish to Christian to Muslim. Some of the Muslim tradition, which is some of the more mathematical of the tradition, and because Allah is viewed by many in the Muslim tradition to be more fate than personality, there is a very strong component in natural theology that is satisfied with finding any evidence for first cause or any argument philosophically for first cause. The personality of that, the agency of that, is less important. And because of the Ottoman Empire's influence through the Mediterranean and the brilliant mathematical minds that came up into Spain, much of the history of Christian natural theology is very much taken by the Muslim tradition. And so to establish in this infinite regress of material objects a first cause for the universe and the agency by which that first cause moved to expand the universe that is sufficient. So you can find natural theologians, I keep saying that, it's practitioners of natural theology. You can find them who would say, yes, we have significant philosophical arguments here, and actual case, I hesitate to say evidence, because when I say that in this present audience, we hear proof. But that word is not being used the way we want to force it. But yes, we see indications of first cause agency. We just don't know about the personhood, the personality of it. The authors of this book here are all Christian philosophers who are hoping that they can continue the field of natural theology toward some kind of convincing argument for personhood.
Bernie?
I would say basically to disprove God, basically, or to show that God does not exist, we take the gods one by one, and maybe starting with some of the easier ones. It's like, we all agree Zeus doesn't exist. Why is that? Let's talk about that. And usually, to disprove that gods exist, you have to start with the definition. And so, for example, you know, there's Yahweh and Jesus. And so, like, for example, the God of the Bible, you just have to define what did this God do. So, you know, this is where the science comes in. I mean, if your God is the one that made Adam and Eve, then that God could be disproved. But so that's just disproving the God of the young earthers, you know. So maybe those guys will move on to old earthers, or maybe they'll just say, hey, well, now I can't trust the Bible anymore. I'm out of here, because I'm not going to interpret the Bible in a more liberal way. But if you do interpret it more in a liberal way, you could be an old earth creationist, and you can prove why they're wrong about evolution. So then you can either leave the faith at that point, or you can say, no, okay, I'll just interpret the Bible more liberally again, then you can be an evolutionary creationist. So then you can use philosophy to show, like, the problem of evil. So, personally, that's why I didn't want to stick around, because I saw it as an issue of intellectual honesty. You know, we could always say, well, there's these inconsistencies, and I don't know, maybe someday we'll get an answer in heaven. Or you can say, let's draw the logical conclusion. You know, if we have the conclusion that God doesn't exist, wow, all these mysteries just disappeared and now things make sense. But if you want to believe in God and in light of all these complexities, then you have all this contention. So, intellectually, I think things make more sense when you look at it that way.
Chad, what was your first point you had? The God of the...
God of the gaps.
God of the gap. So what you're saying, and I'm stepping out of my moderator's role here, I apologize, but I want you to think, Bernie, about, is atheism your non-God of the gap, since you jumped all the way to atheism rather than sticking around?
Yeah, so some people say, like, okay, you don't have God of the gaps, so you have nature of the gaps. You know, there's these questions we don't know, and you just assume nature can fill those. The response there usually is that, look at the track record through history, as we've seen, you know, you plug God into all these gaps, and one by one, it falls off, and, like, God's retreating more and more and more and more and more. So it's that the history is showing, and this is why science and technology is so successful, and why we depend on it so much, is because of the history. So basically, we're depending on it because of the history that's showing it's reliable. So it just looks like all indications look like the more you trust nature, it works out. And by going with those conclusions, you can move forward. If you don't move forward, your competitor will, and he'll get farther ahead. So if you regard all the supernatural stuff as superstition, that usually helps you get ahead, technically.
Okay.
So it seems like there's success in the historical record.
Another question. Yes?
Thank you both for the time, the energy you put into this. You both are taking huge risks to be quoted or misquoted with very strongly felt perspectives from opposite sides. So thank you very much for that. I would imagine that any text on natural theology presents the moral argument. And I'm wondering if both of you, from your respective worldviews, could kind of teach us on where you feel morality comes from, and maybe if you're able to kind of give us some of the weaknesses of your own worldview when it comes to that as well.
Which one wants to go first?
Well, I always have a weakness when you ask me about the... I have a problem when you ask me about the weaknesses of my own worldview, because maybe I'm blind or I'm too dumb, but I don't really see a lot of weaknesses. So I'm sorry, I can't really say I have weaknesses in my worldview. It's hard for me to identify those. But on the moral argument, yeah, I had like three or four slides on that. One of the most terrible, I thought, dumb things in this book was they say that, well, they bring the question about you can't get an ought from an is. And what that means is, like, for example, if you say murder is bad, you know, we can understand that. But why would you say you ought not murder? How do you get that ought? Why is there a compelling thing there? And it's really quite simple. If you know what good and bad is, and you say something's good, and you want to be good, then that's what you ought to do. There's really, I don't see much mystery in it. And so it seemed to me I just didn't have very much respect for him when he had such a simple question like that. I had like three slides full of moral questions.
Could I rephrase the question a little bit, Bernie?
Sure.
From an evolutionary biopsychology viewpoint, where does the existence of morality come from?
Yeah, so I've talked about this numerous times. Basically, my morality, I say, could be from a rubric of three things. If you have any kind of moral question, consequentialism is one, individual rights is another one, and reciprocity is a third one. Some moral issues are heavy on one of those, and you know, another moral issue might be heavy on another one, and sometimes there's two at play, like there's consequentialism versus reciprocity. So sometimes they're tricky. But in all cases, there is no such thing like killing is bad, or killing is sometimes good. Sometimes it's good to kill to save other lives. You know, sometimes a sniper has to do that. You know, there's no such thing as absolute. It's moral absolutes like that. If you say something like rape is a moral absolute, well, that's just because it's so extremely violating consequentialism, reciprocity, and individual rights. It's just so obvious because it's so extreme. But some of them are more complicated, so there's a lot of interplay there. So
Nathan.
Well, to answer from, there's a chapter that Mark Linville writes on the moral argument in the book. And in short, what he's saying is that even though Hume, followed by Immanuel Kant, both put forth philosophical arguments that we cannot prove from nature or from reason that God exists, Kant was disturbed with that, starting from where Hume had brought everyone in the world. And Mark Linville's point is that we live in a Kantian world now. And what really disturbed Immanuel Kant, as the son of a Lutheran minister who had veered and strayed away from actual practice in the church, was the way that human beings treat people with indignity, the devaluing of human beings. And so he decided that the real problem in philosophy wasn't Hume saying we can't prove God. The real problem was Jeremy Bentham saying that the estimation of human value is social utility. And so Immanuel Kant began to argue philosophically that human worth cannot be utilitarian, that was the real philosophical problem. And so he reinserted, to maintain human dignity, he reinserted at the bottom and working up the Ten Commandments that he learned as a child. And he said, these Ten Commandments promote human dignity. And so from that, he builds his philosophic grid to say, we should consider that God exists. Now, some of you are shaking your heads and smiling and saying, that's backward. That is non-scientific. It's actually brilliant. The Kantian grid is in place today. And hardly anyone in this room or in this world can think outside the Kantian grid. In other words, he, at the top, trying to work from the top down, he couldn't prove God. So he went down to the bottom and he said, I don't want to treat my neighbor like crap. What do I need? The Ten Commandments. And he worked his way back up to God. And so what is the weakness in Christian morality? I think the weakness is that because God is philosophically and scientifically elusive, and we go around digging in the debris of carbon looking for divine clues. Because that is the case, we oftentimes we regress into legalism, and we add all too many personal rules of our own that make us look good and our neighbors look bad. And we say, God has given to us these rules and I'm following them, and you're not, you're really a bad person. And that kind of legalism creeps up in Christianity because we won't come to terms with the fact that there is a God who speaks, and he alone gets to define the rules for behavior. And when we reinsert humanity and we say, oh, we're worth so much, we can be gods ourselves. So, you know, Christianity, I know this is probably a hard sell on most of you, because you know that Christians have done horrible things in history and in the present. But actually, the big mistake in Christianity is elevating humanity, the human race, to such a high elevation as the chief of all creation, that sometimes we forget our foibles, and that all we can do is dig for carbon gems, that's all we can do.
Can I make a quick comment?
Sure.
I think it's really overly simplistic to look at the Ten Commandments, for example, thou shalt not lie or bear false witness. I mean, that is just wrong. For example, if you're hiding Jews in the war, and the Nazis come and say, are there any Jews here? There is not wrong to lie. It's all relative. So it's just overly simplistic to say, oh, there are rules like do not murder, or do not kill, or do not lie. It's so simplistic, it's wrong.
I've never heard anyone call Moses or Immanuel Kant simplistic. Never.
Okay, we'll get Daniel and then you next, Gavin. Go ahead, Daniel.
So my little thing is for Bernie, and it's sort of a question and a challenge. So my question for Bernie is, you said earlier that you were happy when you were part of the church, and you were happy with the idea of, you know, you were going to live forever after you died in the love, and then you thought it was a delusion and it was fake, and so now you're in this other state of mind now. But I mean, I think you mentioned that, you know, it's fine because it makes you feel good. Where my question is, how does atheism or secular humanism make you feel good? And my challenge to you is, if Christianity is fake, or if it's just us messing around and making up little games, then I kind of think that if our game is so much more fun, and it makes us happy, and you can see that we're happy, then I kind of think our game, we have a game that sort of smashes your reality to little pieces.
So we're going to have more downloads, Daniel?
Yeah, so I mean, it boils down to, do you want, what's more important to you, to be happy or to know the truth, if it came down to that? You know, like, so in the Bible, Jesus says, you know, what was it about, joy will come bubbling out of you like waters kind of thing? I can't remember the exact verse. Was it the waters will gush out of you, something like that? You know the Bible verse?
Living waters.
Yeah.
It's something about like, oh, like a spring of, you're like a spring of water. You're not drinking water, but it's like a spring of water welling up to eternal life. I can't remember how it goes, but anyway, as a Christian, I felt that way. I felt like I was, you know, I had this joy of God, and I was just, you know, on cloud nine. Also, when I was a Christian, I was meeting with some Mormons, and they said to pray about the Book of Mormon. You'll get a burning in the bosom if it's true, you know, to pray for that. And I got that. And then I realized, I mean, it lasts about 10 seconds because my brain said, well, you know, you can't believe this because of what you know, because I knew a lot about Mormonism. So my brain saved me from my heart. So basically, the way I see it, it's kind of like, you know, like an alcoholic, he can feel really good too when he's drunk and he likes to drink. And when you're sober, you don't feel that happiness when you're drunk. But you can have a different pleasure when you're sober, knowing that you're sane and you can see the world, and maybe you're being responsible and you're being mature, you're being more intellectual. And so for me, I would say the difference is like that. Do you want to be like a sober person or do you want to be like a drunk person? That's just being honest. I'm not trying to put anybody down. That's just how I view it.
Then again, I would sort of challenge you though too. I mean, if it was that great and you said you actually felt that joy, then why would you even consider needing that?
Because it's the same. Because basically, truth seeking is my number one value. I want to know the truth. And the reason why for that really is because I think if you're not in the truth, it's going to give you a lot of pain. You know, like for example, the doctor tells you you have cancer and you go, no, I'm not going to believe it. Denial is the first thing for when you try to face some bad news, denial. And usually what happens is it comes to a lot of pain. Sooner or later, you get smacked around. So I thought, you know, I don't want a painful life. I want to have a good life. And I think if you're in the truth, you have a good life. And so that's why I put the truth above everything, even the pleasure. So, yeah.
I've been a Christian for many decades, and I tell you, it's not all fun and games. Anyway, Gavin.
Hi there. I got a question for Pastor Nathan. When it comes to the Ten Commandments, we got the version in Exodus and the restatement in Deuteronomy. We got the way the Catholic faith numbers them, the way the Protestant faith numbers them, and the way the Jewish faith, or at least one of the faiths, number them. So regarding the first commandment, what would you say that is?
Right. I mean, this could all be cleared up if we could find that Ark of the Covenant with the tablets in it now, couldn't we? It could be in Ethiopia, or it could be in the Dead Letter Office. But
I'm asking you what the first commandment is.
Yeah, the first commandment is, you shall have no other gods before me.
Okay, and I noticed like in Exodus, before it says that, it says, I am the Lord or Yahweh your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. So when you were saying earlier, there was, if I understood you correctly, you were saying that there was this man who derived the conclusion that God exists from the Ten Commandments. But the Ten Commandments starts off by saying there is a God named Yahweh, and you must not have any other gods before him. So you already are assuming that God exists when you come to your conclusion that God exists from that assumption. So am I missing something here?
Yeah, you're missing. What Immanuel Kant did is he just took some moral data that he knew personally from his childhood. And that's where he started his argument.
So when
philosophically,
he started with the Ten Commandments, he really started with commandments 2 through 10 and not 1 through 10?
Well, no, I think you are missing the point. You and I really enjoy, even though you're an atheist and I'm a Christian, we know because we've talked about this, we both enjoy looking at the scriptures and trying to contextually understand them. And that's the Ten Commandments are given there as in an ancient suzerainty treaty form, where the king says, this is who I am, and this is what I've done for you. Therefore, you have to follow these laws. If you disobey these laws, I'm going to punish you. If you obey these laws, I'm going to reward you. And that's the Semitic, the ancient cuneiform king order that's there. Kant wasn't looking at all of that contextual data. He was just saying, let's start with some moral data that there's, you know, a good number of people who are saying, we want to value humanity. We will take these rules because we believe they will help us value humanity, and I'm going to argue from there. That's what he was doing.
And what was the conclusion that Kant reached? There was trying to reach from that?
That there is philosophically the possibility of God because these rules and communities exist.
Okay. Yes, sir. In the back.
I have questions for Bernie. I have two quotes for you from Nietzsche. He says, we have art in order to not die of the truth. And he also says, the thought of suicide is a great comfort by means of it we get through many a dark night. And so my question to you is basically, I guess, challenging you to, I think you're being intellectually honest in trying to state that you believe that your system of thought is positive, but I do agree with Richard that it's thoroughly inconsistent, and that how can you sit in this room and disavow the logical conclusion that without a God, without a superintending purpose, without a supernatural person, a personal God looking after your needs and cares, how can you end up anywhere different than the two quotes that I just gave you with Nietzsche?
And before Bernie answers, you want to repeat those two quotes, John?
Yes, we have art in order to not die of the truth. Basically, the arts, whatever, these are all basically, everything man creates is a distraction from the misery that we live in the world. And then, you know, his logical conclusion is that only by means that we can end our lives anytime we choose to can we get through each day. The thought of suicide is a great relief. By means of it, we can get through many a dark night.
Well, that might be an interesting topic. We never talked about suicide before. So, not sure where to start on this. I had so many ideas when you were talking. Okay, so when you're a Christian, there is a strong, if you're a real strong Christian, there's a strong belief like I would, that I had, that you're going to live forever in heaven. You're going to have eternal life. When you become an atheist and you give up belief in God, that is an incredible, painful thing to deal with, that, wow, I have to deal with my mortality. It really strikes at the heart of our survival instinct as animals. We've been bred with a survival instinct. Just think, if we didn't have that, we would be eaten up real quick. So the ones who have the survival instinct are the ones who survive. So we have an extremely, you know, just like there's a strong sex drive, we have an extremely strong survival nature, or survival instinct. So this is a big thing that we had to face. Now, I've heard some atheists who've grown up from the cradle, they don't have this problem so much because they've always been used to the idea, sure, I'm going to die someday. But it's even more difficult when you come from Christianity because you had this thing that you believed in strongly and it was ripped from you. So I would just say that knowing there is no God and knowing there is no eternal life, I don't think it logically follows that everything is hopeless or meaningless or it doesn't matter, you might as well kill yourself. Why can it also logically follow that now you're also totally free to live the life you can, whatever you want to do? I think either one is fine, but yeah, there's no way to go back to I'm going to live forever, you know? It all comes down to trying to deal with that survival instinct of humans. And this is one reason why it's going to be extremely hard for religion to ever go extinct, because they're inventing ways of saying, hey, denial is okay, don't worry about it, you're not going to die, you're going to live forever, it's going to be reincarnation or resurrection or something. Hey, you know, don't worry about it. It soothes the survival instinct. So this is part of being a sober-minded intellectual person, I think, trying to deal with the consequences of reality. And I think there are some positive aspects to it.
Okay, we're right on the limit, and I'm going to ask, I see two hands. I think we're going to have to just go right to thing, and I ask you, ma'am, I'm going to ask Isaac if you'd come up afterwards, and these guys will be stick around and answer your questions for as long as they'd like, and that goes for the rest of you too. One of the things that is really enjoyable about these sessions is the gab fests that happen after hours. So each of you have, what did we agree on, a minute or was it 2 minutes?
Just a minute, I think.
A minute, okay. A minute to summarize your point of view on natural theology. So have at it.
I'll go first.
Okay, go ahead.
Then Pastor can close since he's hosting here. So basically, my viewpoint of this was, you know, the reason why I actually selected this book, and the reason why is because I want to know the best arguments that the Christians had to offer. And this is a recent book, it's 2012, and it's edited by William Lane Craig, who's supposed, in my mind, is one of the best Christian debaters. I mean, who's a better debater? There's Dinesh D'Souza, who's okay, but
one thing that makes him a good debater is he says he's not going to debate evolution because he knows it's not something you want to argue about. So, and it's kind of funny in here too because on one of the chapters, one of the authors he says that he's basically a lapsed Protestant because he doesn't really go for the fall narrative. And I think, that's kind of interesting in here. This is supposed to be like an evangelical Christian thing, I thought. And right off the bat, he's distancing himself from the fall doctrine. And there was another thing there too that was perplexing. But anyway, in my viewpoint, it was not a compelling case, and so I'll leave it to Eric.
Okay.
Nathan?
Thanks, Bernie. Thanks for suggesting the book. Natural science has not solved the problem of the universe equation. Not yet. But natural science has done something wonderful for us in the last few years. It's returned us to the 13th century. Welcome back to the 13th century, where Aquinas said there is infinite regress and there's first cause. What natural science has been unable to do is show to us that the first cause or agency of the universe is personal. Natural theology employs philosophies and theologies, integrates all science toward further discovery. Natural science tends to specialize, to ostracize, heavily favoring physics. And that is changing now because of quantum physics and string theory. Bernie's not happy with this book. Let me tell you a book that I'm happy with, the Bible. But that's special revelation. And in special revelation, we have included Psalm 19, the heavens declare the glory of God. This ancient verse has given rise to natural theology. It encourages natural theology. Is there a personal fingerprint of God in nature? What if a personal God exists? Would he not create beyond rocks and single cell organisms? Would he not create personhood and community? Would he not unfold a history? Would he not tell and own a story? If there is a personal God, would he not reveal and speak? Would he not create, redeem, and restore? How far would a personality go? Incarnation, crucifixion, resurrection, glorification? But that's all special revelation. The strength of natural theology is its leaving of all this personality equation to the doctors of special revelation. The weakness of that natural theology is its perceived abandonment of special revelation, scurrying about in the carbon debris of this world looking for clues of the divine. The authors of the Blackwell Companion of Natural Theology have uncovered a sizable heap of clues. Thanks.
And I want to thank each and every one of you for coming here and participating. Is there another one scheduled here?
Not yet.
So we'll put these guys will put their heads together, and we will schedule another one soon. You can look at the Evergreen website or Bernie's meetup.com website and find out the details. Thank you again for coming.